Anglo-Saxons, who took their ideas directly from St. Augustine and Rome, had no problem drawing man and his feet naturalistically. This is the Durham Cassiodorus. It's a fantastic Anglo-Saxon manuscript. Take a look at the figure here. It's far more naturalistic and realistic. And the treatment of the feet, no cloven hooves here. The artist has even included tiny little toenails. It's far more in keeping with the classical tradition of art that's coming out of Rome. The Celtic and Anglo-Saxon Christians couldn't even agree when to celebrate Easter. And although these different approaches to drawing feet may seem trivial to us now, at the time they represented a real fundamental difference between the two Christian camps. These two artistic styles may seem irreconcilable, but the life of one man was to inspire an artwork that would bring the two together. His name was St. Cuthbert, and he spent most of his life on the holy island of Lindisfarne. St. Cuthbert was one of Lindisfarne's earliest bishops. The most remarkable thing about Cuthbert was he was all things to all men. He was a nobleman, a hermit, a monk, and a bishop. And in death, he was to become one of the Anglo-Saxons' most treasured saints. In 687, Cuthbert died and was buried here. 11 years later, the monks of Lindisfarne opened his coffin and made an amazing discovery. Cuthbert didn't rot. Because of this, he was declared a saint and a cult would grow up around him. In death, Cuthbert managed one final miraculous act, and it would reconcile the artistic differences between the Anglo-Saxon and Celtic churches. He inspired another bishop of Lindisfarne, Eadfrith, to create a manuscript of such beauty, it would become one of the pinnacles of Anglo-Saxon artistic achievement. This is it. This is the Lindisfarne Gospels. The finest piece of art from the Dark Ages and a national treasure. Well, this isn't actually it, the original's in the British Library. But this one manuscript is the culmination of centuries of Anglo-Saxon artistic endeavour. And not only that, it manages to resolve the stylistic differences of the two Christian factions. Look at it in a little more detail. Here we have an image of Matthew the Evangelist writing in his gospel book. And if you look at details like the feet, you can see the same sort of imagery that we saw in the Durham Cassiodorus. That naturalistic treatment of the figure that's coming directly from Rome with St. Augustine. And alongside this, we get these full-page illuminations called carpet pages, where the swirls move the eye from image into text. But look at this carpet page in detail. Here we've got Celtic walls and spirals, just like we saw in the McDernan Gospels, here in the borders. They knot along the edges here. And then we've also got Anglo-Saxon animal interlace, just like we saw on the Sutton Hoo belt buckle, where the serpents and beasts wound into one another. And if you look at this carpet page, it's the same imagery that we've seen on the Sutton Hoo shoulder clasps. Look at the centre, the exact same geometric patterning. It It's no accident that they're called carpet pages. They certainly resemble Islamic prayer rugs, and it's possible that Eadfrith had actually seen a Middle Eastern carpet. He certainly had an encyclopedic knowledge of Celtic, Anglo-Saxon, and Christian art of Rome. Today, the Lindisfarne Gospels are considered one of the world's greatest artworks, but less than a century after they were made, they were nearly destroyed by a new wave of violent, bloodthirsty pagan invaders. In 793, the Vikings sacked Lindisfarne, slaughtering their monks and plundering their treasures. By 871, nearly all the Anglo-Saxon kingdoms had been defeated and ravaged by the marauding Vikings. Only the newly crowned King of Wessex stood against them. His name was Alfred, Alfred the Great, and Winchester was his capital city. Under Alfred, Winchester became the very model of Anglo-Saxon civilization, a place where art and culture would flourish. During his reign, Alfred introduced many concepts we take for granted today, like taxes to pay for the defence of his cities. However, he would never decisively defeat the Vikings, but he did stop them from conquering England completely. Winchester Cathedral was built by the people that did ultimately conquer Anglo-Saxon England, the Normans. But beneath it lies the remains of a great Anglo-Saxon cathedral. During his 28 years on the throne, Alfred made the building of new churches and monasteries a priority. The church and his faith were very important to Alfred. He believed the reason that the Vikings had come to rape and pillage his land was simple. His people were not pious enough. To atone for this lack of piety, Alfred made the production of art dedicated to the glory of God his mission. And this is his legacy. It became known as the Winchester School, and it shows how the artistry and creativity of the Anglo-Saxons developed in later centuries. There's still loads of Anglo-Saxon motifs here. The bold use of colour, gold, this interlacing knotwork here. And as we move on to later works, you see even more naturalism and movement in pieces like this. Look at the treatment of the figure and the drapery here. And then there's an increasing freedom of expression in pieces like this, where the characters are filling the space and pouring out across the illumination. And looking at this, you can really see why Anglo-Saxon manuscripts became such highly prized artworks throughout Europe. The freedom and expressiveness of the late Anglo-Saxon period was not limited to manuscripts. There was one piece of jewellery that, when it was found, looked so fresh and was in such good condition, the British Museum thought it was fake. Of all the works produced in the late Anglo-Saxon period, for me, this, the Fuller Brooch, represents most clearly both where Anglo-Saxon art has come from and where it's heading to. It's personal, it's portable and shiny, just like the other early Anglo-Saxon warrior bling. But the animals and pagan symbols have now virtually gone. It represents the five senses and the four stages of life around the edge. The most important thing is the treatment of the figures. You can see that there's very little naturalism. Take a look at this central character. The eyes are so enlarged, and the face has been reduced just to the basic features. Then you have these figures around the side. Their bodies are elongated, their gowns are turned into abstract patterns, and they're surrounded by these shapes and arrows. All of this treatment of figural depiction was to disappear for another 1,000 years. That is, until Picasso. But of course, the Anglo-Saxons never did get as far as Picasso. The Bayeux tapestry tells the story of their defeat. At the Battle of Hastings, the Anglo-Saxons were the losers. And history, even art history, is always written by the winners. After their victory in 1066, this is one of the first works of art the Normans commissioned. For me, the Bayeux tapestry lacks the sort of imagination and artistic freedom that made the Anglo-Saxons so special. As I look at this replica now, how it follows step by step the story of the Norman victory, I can't help but wonder how different the story of Anglo-Saxon art would have been were they not defeated and so many of their treasures lost. But maybe this is one of the beauties of Anglo-Saxon art. The fact that so much of it was buried for 1,000 years in the British countryside means that today we can see it with truly fresh eyes. And with every new discovery, our understanding of the Anglo-Saxons will keep changing and shine a new light on the Dark Ages.
And the Norman season continues with the Normans tomorrow at 9 over on BBC Two. And here on BBC Four, Dan Snow's Norman Walks continues tomorrow at 10. Next tonight, we meet Christina in a medieval life.